Ladies and gentlemen, it is a real pleasure for me to introduce to talk about his wonderful book, A Meritopia, that I'm just getting into. As you know, somebody, I said, swiped mine from the station. I then found it right in the middle of my desk. They put it back the other day. Must have felt bad about it. As you know, I've told you before, I'm a very slow reader. There are reasons for that. I'll get into it someday. But I've started to get into this today. I'm very impressed. And the author, I wanted to have him on like earlier so we could say it is today that made it number one on the New York Times bestseller list. Number one, but it's already reached there. It has reached there, and it's going to be one of the best-selling books of all time. Hopefully, you will go out and get it and read it in this election year. As I said to our listeners yesterday, you've got to get involved with your neighbors before it's too late. Mark Levin, great to have you with us, buddy. How are you?
My brother, Tom Maher. You know what? I don't know that we've ever told your audience how you've always been a promoter of my career.
From the very early days.
From the very early days, but even at Landmark Legal Foundation.
Absolutely.
So I'm indebted to you, and you're definitely one of my permanent, you know, guest hosts, because, well, you're terrific at what you do. Obviously.
Well, Valentine's Day, that says it all. You're letting me do it Valentine's Day.
Well, of course.
Don't want to start.
Who else would I pick?
Don't want to start rumors. I want to get into A Meritopia in a moment, because I can see that it's a quick read, that it's a history lesson, that it's really important for younger people to read this, because they're not learning any of this in school. They're learning about feelings and emotions and nothing about history. But it just so happens in the first hour of the show today, it took off like a rocket when we announced, and I announced and learned for the first time, that there is an official now government program, if you're at 135% of the poverty level, to get a free cell phone and a camera phone along with it with 90 minutes. We've already heard from a lady who works for the post office how they've scammed the system now and people are getting 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 phones. But shouldn't we always have expected under a meritopia for the government to give us our cell phones anyway?
I mean, this is a complete deterioration of our society, our ethic, the American spirit, individual sovereignty. This is, it's only going to get worse because, unless we figure out how to put a stop to it, because we're unmoored from our Constitution now. And that's the whole point of the book, Tom. One of the chapters is entitled Post-Constitutional America. And what authority does the federal government have to do any of this?
That's page 183.
Page 183. Right. Now, the point is this. I felt after Liberty and Tyranny, which was a big hit, I kept thinking about it. You know, that came out 3 years ago, believe it or not. I kept thinking to myself, okay, from my perspective, I've explained conservatism and reintroduced it, and non-conservatism in, you know, in a book form. But what is it more deeply that keeps, what is this allure that millions of Americans have for their own destruction? And on the other hand, why isn't what you and I and our listeners believe in, the individual sovereignty and constitutionalism and consent of the governed, why isn't this more popular? And what are the foundational philosophers behind that? Because, you know, the founders didn't wake up one day, Tom, and say, hey, I believe in unalienable rights and consent of the governed. They got these ideas from somewhere. And I just thought, okay, I have really got to dig into this, because if this society is going to be saved, I think more and more of our listeners need to know the roots of the evil that's on the other side, and yet the roots of the enlightenment that's on our side. That's why I decided to dig deep and get into this. Is a book really on political philosophy, and at the end, I tie it all together with what's going on in the country today.
Well, and let me tell our listeners, you can get it at, if you go into a bookstore and they don't have it or they're hiding it, call us, because then we do call them on the air and ask them why they're hiding. No, we will in
I
a heartbeat.
That.
Why are you hiding Mark Levin's book in your store?
Well, you know what? You can always go to Amazon. They're not hiding it.
And they're not hiding it at Amazon.com. Find out more about it at MarkLevinShow.com as well. But what really bothers me now, Mark, when you're talking about this, is that, number one, I used to have a modicum of respect for Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Yeah.
And I'm now hearing on these panel shows for the first time in my life, and I've been observing this kind of thing for a long time, people are actually talking about how the Constitution is getting in the way and maybe it has outlived its usefulness. And you know what? The Constitution is for me. It's about me. It leaves me alone unless I do something where I should not be left alone. It is about individualism. It is about me and my family. And I can slowly see this creeping in. I used to worry about the children and grandchildren. Let me tell you, bro, you and I are going to see it go if we don't act quickly. And this current crowd that's running this country, it has no respect for it, none whatsoever. It's in their way.
You just said something that's crucial. It's in their way. You cannot have this utopian tyranny or utopian statism and constitutionalism. And the reason is, Tom, because you have these masterminds, self-appointed, whether it's Ruth Bader Ginsburg or Barack Obama or the editorial page editor for the for your Baltimore paper, which is quite left-wing and so forth. These people hold themselves out as smarter than all the riffraff. That would be you and me and our listeners. Somehow, though, our society has spit these people out as masterminds, as philosopher kings, as Plato would call them. And what they plan to do and what they are doing is they are attacking the nature of man, the nature of the individual, his free will. They want to reshape us. They want to mold us into drones, into people who will be dependent. That's why Obama is constantly attacking successful, industrious, independent individuals. He calls them rich. He calls them this. He calls them that, whomever they are, because they must be driven down. They must be sabotaged, because the goal is to destroy this society or fundamentally transform it, as he puts it, and to replace it with an abstraction, a fantasy, a phony paradise. And you've seen this throughout history, which is why I go back to Plato and come forward, because I promise you, if Plato couldn't come up with an ideal society in the Republic, and he doesn't, and he abandons it, Barack Obama's not going to come up with one. The problem is we all have to suffer through the indignity of it, through the misery of it. And what I'm trying to explain in this book in ways that I don't think has been explained before by going through real heavy philosophy and putting it in plain English so it's understandable and concisely putting it, is, folks, mankind has been here before. There are no new experiments that are going to work. Obama's not going to eliminate unemployment. He's not going to eliminate wage gaps. He's not going to eliminate poverty. He's not going to do all those things. What he's going to do is destroy us. And the greatest country on the face of the earth is great, not because of government, but because of the people. And the Constitution recognizes that, and the Constitution limits the power of the central government, which these utopian statists reject, which is why they attack the Constitution and evade the Constitution. This has been going on for a long time, Tom, but now they're flat out of the closet.
Well, they're not only out of the closet, but and by the way, we are, as you point out in your book here, we're the most generous nation in the world.
Yeah.
I mean, we are the most charitable people in the world. We're not going to let anybody go hungry. If anybody's going hungry in our country right now, it is the fault of the parent or some individual. But they want to make sure that there's free breakfast, free lunch, free dinner. Then you don't need the food stamps. I'd eliminate that program except for the elderly tomorrow. But it's always more, 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 more. Now it's a cell phone. The next thing you know, they'll be giving us the damn Chevy Volts, not us, but they'll give the Chevy Volt away because they can't sell it. And they have already.
The point is it always has to be more because it can't work. I was watching Neil Cavuto yesterday, great guy, on the Fox News channel. He was interviewing one of these congressmen from the Bay Area, and he said the problem has been the president hasn't done enough. You know, we need more spending, more program. This is always going to be the problem because utopian statism is a failure. It cannot work. It is anti-human nature. It is miserable. I don't care how they package it. I don't care how many malcontents and miscreants they attract. I don't care how many of our fellow citizens are blissfully living their lives, not recognizing they're losing their liberty. The fact of the matter is, this cannot work, and it'll never work. And in a constitutional republic, which we used to have, you have to destroy the foundational principles of the society in order to impose this top-down authoritarianism on the people.
Well, I've seen it firsthand. I was in Moscow for a conference in 1987. Of a journalist, and I was supposed to be there 9 days. I had to escape after six. I saw how it was working then. That's when Reagan had worked with Margaret Thatcher and the Pope to start to bring down the Soviet Empire, but even then you could see how bad it was. I had to get out of the place. I had to leave it. That's how horrible it was. I've also seen it in Cuba, and we are headed down that street, but Barack Obama and his type and Nancy Pelosi, they will always have the elite life and their own personal Air Force over at Andrews Air Force Base. They will live well while the rest of us will not be left alone and will have to count on the government for everything, including they will give us a cheap watch so we can tell what time of day it is.
Well, and even at some point along the road, either before that moment or after, you're going to see the unraveling of our society. I'm concerned you're going to see violence. You're going to see disruption of normal lifestyles. We haven't seen it really much in this country. The Constitution's purpose is to protect the society, to preserve the society, to preserve the value, the worth of the individual. And the reason why these folks are abandoning it is not only for the reasons I said, but like Ruth Bader Ginsburg points to these other constitutions, she's doing that because those other constitutions, Tom, this is crucial, institutionalize the left-wing agenda. They institutionalize redistribution of wealth. They institutionalize the power of the central government to create all these programs and push the individual around. The idea that this woman is on the Supreme Court and that she's supposed to interpret our Constitution based on our history and the words in that document, rather than foreign law, rather than foreign influences, which have absolutely nothing to do with our traditions, nothing, is a disgrace. But now it's commonplace. So many of our fellow citizens have been so dumbed down, they don't even understand why we exist in this country the way that we exist. They think this is commonplace.
Well, there are a lot of good people in black robes, but there are dangerous people in black robes as well. And I shudder to think that if this man is elected again, what he would do to the Supreme Court. Oh, my goodness. And people, you know, the average American who wants to see Dancing with the Stars or who's starring in this tonight, yep, doesn't even think about the Supreme Court when they think about the election. They believe the pap and the lies they hear on networks like NBC, the worst of them all, and up Chuck Todd in that crowd.
But you said something there very important. The way I argue this is the circle of liberty that each of us has is getting tighter and tighter, so they don't mind if we go to the movies or if we have an iPod or, you know, we download iTunes and do this, that, and that's all perfectly fine. That keeps us busy, you know. But when it comes to what kind of jobs we want, what kind of business we want to start, how we want to build our homes, what kind of car we want to drive, what kind of food we're going to eat, all the rest of it,
they'll tell us.
They can't stop with the lifestyle calibrations. There's no stopping it, because once you're unmoored from the law, then the law is used against you. And I've made the point, Tom, that apparently to these people, we're wise enough to select our own rulers, but we're too stupid to pick our own light bulbs.
You got it.
Think about that.
I was just going to ask you, have you stocked up on the filament light? It was good enough
I've
for Thomas
them,
Edison.
I got a whole closet full of them.
All right, I did too. Listen, thanks an awful lot. I appreciate it. And,
thanks, brother.
I would enjoy sitting in for you, brother, on the Valentine's Day.
God bless.
Talk to you later. Bye-bye. The great Mark Levin, the great one.